Welcome back to Let's Play, or Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. It is I, Amethyst Lunatari. I realize this episode is 2 days late, but my channel is on a somewhat semi-hiatus, so I've been extremely busy with calls, research, everything. Hopefully from here on in, excepting a few days for traveling, we'll be on time. So anyway, this is an interactive Let's Play where at the end of this episode you get to choose from a selection of choices which will carry forth into the next episode. A majority rules, and in case of a tie there's a... I roll a set of virtual dice, or a virtual die. Anyway, last episode we finally arrived at Mampeng. You take a moment to drink in the sight. Mampeng's walls are towering, and they march away on either side, guard turrets jutting against the pitch-black sky. The fortress is the size of a small city, and somewhere inside is the crown of kings. The gates are sealed for the night, but perhaps you can find a way to sneak inside. Now, it was unanimous last episode. Everyone said to go to the side path, which I believe is a wise decision. You follow the path past the main gate and around the curving stone wall of the fortress. The moon moves slowly across the dark sky. The path opens out here into a wide plateau, directly beneath a guard turret. Under cover of darkness, you should be able to make your way without being noticed. Now, I don't know if it's just luck. I think actually last episode we did wait till night, I believe, along the path. You follow the path further along the curve of the mountainside. Far below, a river rushes at the foot of the deep chasm that opens two steps to your left. Look into the chasm. Hope the chasm does not look back at you. You look down into the chasm. Some black water rushes far beneath, tearing through the underground chasms that skewer the mountain's roots like the rot in an old woman's gums. Huh! Now, there's a image. Look at the wall. You lift your eyes to the wall of the fortress, built from blocks of stone of a size you haven't seen since the ruined steps down into the backlands. They must have been carried and laid by enchantments. No creature could have assembled them on the edge of this precipice with such a narrow space to work. At the end of this path, a side gate is set into the wall. I wasn't planning on climbing, so let's look at the side gate. The side gate is no main entrance, but it is still impressively large. Let me just look, see if there are climbing holds, just out of curiosity. You turn your attention back from the gate and scan over the wall for handholds, but with each block so large there are not enough crevices to climb, and the wall is high as well, tall enough to keep out the prying eyes of a giant. Right, so our enlarging to giant size spell won't work. The path follows the chasm edge. Right, the side gate. Avoiding the watchful eyes of the birdman circling above the ramparts, you sneak towards the door. The side gate is much smaller than the main gate and is probably used for patrols. The moon sets. More stars appear. Hide. Let's see, a reason to hide at this moment. Look at the door. You approach the door, sizing it up. It seems solid enough. You would not be able to smash it open, even if you could do so silently. And there does not seem to be a lock. It must be barred on the other side. There are no Sfin elders to give you a free pass into this walled city. There is a stone overhang over the doorway. You could perch there, but it wouldn't be high enough to climb over the wall. Knock on the door? I think that would be foolish. Climb to the overhang. Guess I'm not sure why I want to climb to the overhang. We could cast a spell of unlocking. I'm just curious to see if we can climb up to the overhang and what the purpose of that would be. You pull yourself up onto the ledge above the door. It is only wide enough to support you, and will take some balance to stay up. Okay, we're going to wait for someone to come out of the door, and maybe sneak in or jump on them or something. I'm going to wait. You wait. Nothing happens. Climb higher? Well, I'm not going to knock on the door. Let's climb higher. That's the only option. You look up the wall for handholds to climb to the top, but the stonework is unnaturally smooth. This is as high as you'll be able to go. You drop back down onto the path. Alright, let's... Oh. You open your arms to cast a spell, but seem to find no starlight above you. There must be some kind of magical defense in place. Wait a second. More stars appear. I call foul. Let's hide behind a bush? I really don't want to knock on the door. I'd rather sneak inside. You hide behind a nearby bush, about 10 feet away from the door. Nothing happens. Hmph. You continue to crouch behind the bush. You feel quite safe, but you are not making any progress. Huh. Throw something at the door? You toss a nearby rock at the door from inside the bush. A moment later, the door opens and a guard pokes his head out. You look over the guard, trying to assess the threat he poses. He is a ragged-looking black elf dressed in patchwork armor. The guard looks around, then steps all the way outside, muttering something to himself. Yeah, let's do it. Throw a rock near him. You toss a pebble to the guard's left, and it strikes the wall just out of sight. The guard shouts, and a second guard emerges. The pair walk around the corner to investigate the noise. Sneak towards the door. Oh, well, that didn't work. Creeping across the bare ground, you slip behind the two guards and into the doorway. You breathe a sigh of relief, only to notice a third guard in front of you, wide-eyed with surprise. You will have to finish him quickly before the other two return. Okay. He's surprised, so maybe a cut will do? Yeah. Giving a chuckle, the black elf guard raises his sword and comes for you. There is no time for hesitation. You swing your sword towards his stomach as he attempts to keep you off balance with a jab. He bellows with rage. Cut again. You strike again. With a blow that could split his skull, you skewer him. The black elf guard dodges as well as he can. Should I risk it? Sideswipe? Ah, damn it. Oh, barely! He barely got me. You risk a new tactic. The black elf guard tries to trip you. Your own petty attack fails to hit. The blow catches you in the stomach and you double over, almost collapsing. He relinquishes the momentum. Okay, I'm gonna defend. Because I need my attack power back. You drop down, protecting yourself as the black elf rushes forward. You step deftly aside. You are for the most part out of harm's way, thanks to your guard. He lifts his short sword against his chest. Now, I wonder if this takes, like, too many turns, the other guards will attack. Cut! Stealing your courage, you rush in, or push in, hoping to skewer the black elf on your blade. Thundering across the floor, you thrust a bold lunge to skewer his heart. He turns your blow smartly away, betraying great discipline. Ah, good. You prime a new attack. Striding in, you steer a piercing stab towards his eye as the black elf guard attacks your chest. The guard stumbles. He is weakening. Do I dare a weak sideswipe? I'm gonna try this fight again, but let's see how we do. You spot an opening. The black elf guard strikes out with one foot. You try to move aside, but you are not fast enough. That terrible wooden club almost crashes down on your skull. The blow catches your shoulder and you are numbed, almost falling. His cautious eyes watch you closely. Taking a chance, you push forwards, chasing the brute with a quick blow, harrying his defenses. The black elf guard evades as best as he can. The guard's eyes are bloodshot and panicked. You prepare a new attack. Grabbing a handful of dust, you throw it into his eyes. You cut the guard down. 5 stamina lost? Shameful. Yeah, I know. I will do a low cut this time. Keeping his temper in check, he disturbs the earth with his taut stance. It's attacking my stomach. Gonna give me indigestion. He's not that tough. The guard stumbles. He is weakening. His trained eyes watch you closely. Doing better this time. You ready a new attack, teasing the brute with a clever nick, wearing him down. The black elf guard ducks unsuccessfully. He lets his newly injured arm dangle. Oh, we're doing very well. You ready another attack. Grabbing a nearby rock, you throw it at the guard's groin. The black elf guard dodges as best as he can. The guard's eyes are bloodshot and panicked. He keeps his distance. Nice. No stamina loss. Flawless fighting. Sweet. Ooh, crap. You cut down the third guard, but hear the footsteps of the other two. You bolt the door, and the guard's angry pounding tells you that they have no control over the magic that keeps it sealed. You've made it inside Mampang. You dash for the doorway, and then gasp with relief. With relief, you are inside. Sweet. But inside will be many new foes. Oh, that's right, I still have my monk habit on. Monk robe. This is a small side yard, with further walls between it and the bulk of Mampang, but it is still inside the citadel. The shadow of Mampang falls over you like a cloak. It is as though the sun itself has dimmed, and you feel suddenly more cold and alone than ever before. Pray? You close your eyes and murmur a prayer. It seems the God of Grace is still with you, but more quiet now. But inside, a woman's voice in your head whispers, "Good luck," before fading into the murmur of waves. Oh, it's what's-her-name. I can't remember her name. And I named an episode after her. You've entered the Citadel of Mampang. Here, no decision can be rewound. Oh, crap. We can't rewind. That's not good. Libra, I believe it is. But the God of Grace, is he more quiet now because maybe he is not pleased with our actions? Or is it just that within the Citadel his strength is not as great? Oh! Crap! That was unexpected. I never saw anything like that before in these episodes. This is nothing but a small enclosure between the barracks and a smaller outer gate. It is most likely used for training exercises and the like. A small fire crackles in a central brazier, and a few guards sit around it. Look around. The side entrance was perhaps designed for the servants and lower classes who once served the sorcerers of the Citadel. It has clearly long since fallen into heavy disuse. A stack of crates rots in one corner, leaning over a heavy inner door that has perhaps not been opened in hundreds of years. Another door in the wall to the southeast seems more commonly used. The guard by the fire talk in low voices. A few guards nod in your direction, and you make a pious gesture in reply. Look at the crates. The crates have been discarded over many years, with those at the bottom rotten to a putrescent pulp, while those at the top are more or less intact. They rise up almost to the level of the inner wall. Look at the barracks. The door to the barracks is hanging open. Peering in, all is quiet and dark. The soldiers at the brazier murmur to one another. Go over to the fire. Sleep now in the fire. Stealing your nerve, you go over to the fire pit where the guards are sitting and take a place on the ground. One looks at you with keen eyes. Who are you, stranger?
A simple monk.
We always have time for women of the cloth, one of the guards replies. The others move aside to make space for you by the fire. After all your experiences so far, it is a strange moment, but not an unwelcome one.
Yeah, again. Wondering if I'm the bad guy, and they're the good guys.
Let's talk to them. Get a little risky, but why not?
You look around the guards, trying to catch one's eye. One smiles thinly.
Are you on watch?
We're on break, the guard replies. The gates are closed, so we're free of merchants for a few merciful hours.
You like the merchants?
Not so much.
Merchants are the worst kind of cowards.
Another agrees. The others nod. You get the impression this is a common line of conversation.
Strange thing to say, you all seem very relaxed.
Is there a way inside the Citadel?
You ask. The men shake their heads. When you're chosen for the outer yards, they get a birdman to drop you over the wall. They're the only ones who come and go, really. No one is taken back.
But the birdmen are granted free passage?
You inquire, vaguely wondering if you can stir up some kind of rebellion amongst the group.
The birdmen are bred from a single homunculus somewhere in the sorcerer's spike, the guard replies. They're all mindlessly loyal, he shrugs. Whereas us, well, you can bash a guard about and pay him, but you can't ever be sure he won't turn on you.
There's a grumbled murmur of agreement.
No way inside at all?
Well, one sighs, I heard a rumor that there is a tunnel in the larder somewhere, but if there was, we'd all have been down in, wouldn't we?
Throg doesn't let anyone in his larder, another points out.
The fire in the brazier gutters. One of the guards goes over to the stack of crates, breaks off some wood, and brings it back to fling on the flames.
Rest here? Why not?
You lie back, curling up by the heat of the fire, and fall asleep to the gentle murmur of the guard's conversation. It is a calm, rare moment of companionship. You have eaten nothing today.
Let's eat something.
You eat the hunk of cooked meat, feeling much better for it. Then you close your eyes and let your tiredness overtake you.
Dream.
The night is filled with vivid dreams. You feel a hot wind gathering around your body. You are lifted into the biting air and pulled across the Citadel. A dark, brooding shadow awaits at the end of your flight that grows larger and larger with every passing moment.
There's a voice.
Ah, comes a voice, cracked with age and hollowed by soulless laughter. There you are.
Where am I?
You stand on an open balcony, ooh, color image, with a view across endless frozen wastes. A figure stands before you and turns to greet you.
Finally, breathes the Archmage of Mampang, I've been trying to reach you for so long.
In his hand is a brass pendulum and a crown.
The crown of kings.
What is this place?
You ask.
This? He sweeps an arm across the mountaintops. This is High Zaman, the roof of the world and the well of all powers, the closest place to the stars. Here a sorcerer is triple what she can be elsewhere.
He grins. Sadly, however, you are not here. I have simply summoned your dreaming eye to my presence, like an obedient dog. But here you see me as I am. I have the crown.
Well, I could be threatening, factual, or, threatening.
Okay, so, yeah, is that true? High Zaman.
Aren't we at High Zaman?
Maybe my spells can be triple their strength.
The crown, yeah. It belongs to the King of Annaland.
Now, I'm sure you know what the crown does, the Archmage responds calmly. No one will take it from me, not at least some ill-equipped, half-starved sorcerer novice.
I am no novice, you reply.
Child, I am an archmage, he replies. It is not an honorific title. I wield more power in my sleep than you would standing on a mountaintop.
He sighs and turns the crown in his hand this way and that.
It is beautiful, though, is it not?
Worth dying for?
Ask yourself that.
I'm 1,015 years old, he replies. I don't expect to die any time soon.
For a moment you feel the mountains underneath you shiver and twist. Clearly whatever spell is being cast here is beginning to fade away.
Only 1,015 years old.
Why did you bring me here?
You are hunting me, are you not?
Well then, here I am. Take a look at your quarry.
You will not turn me from my quest.
I have no doubt. But know this. He fixes you with eyes as empty as smoked glass. I am the greatest seer that has ever lived. I have explored every possibility, and I know something to be true. If you come to Manpeng, you will die.
If you go to Zahatum, you will die.
Then why do you fear me so?
You retort. I am only concerned for your well-being, as for all my subjects, as any father would be.
The Archmage smiles meanly.
I will end your tyranny.
Very well, then. He nods and bows. You are welcome to come and die in my great house.
Then his smile becomes a scowl. Only wipe your boots.
And with a flick of the wrist, you are dismissed, tossed like a stone back across the mountains, a mocking laugh ringing in your ears.
You have found one new clue.
The side yard. During the past day, you gained some provisions, plus two, and lost a little gold, minus one. Entered the Citadel of Manpeng, descended into the Ark Bag crater, and found three new clues. The Archmage is still looking for you. And the music is still loud as hell. You get to your feet. The guards have returned to their posts, and the brazier is just ashes once more. The sun breaks over the eastern wall. The brazier is now dark. You will need to find a way further inwards.
All right, what's our clue?
A tunnel inside from the larder. There are rumors of a tunnel leading from the outer yards into inner Manpeng from the larder.
Yeah.
Seems like a good idea. Either that, or if we get one of the rebel birdmen to help us. Of course, who knows if the birdmen we run into will be the rebel birdman. Okay. So right now we can only go to the old door and the crates. Let's check out the crates anyway. Even though I already looked at them. You make your way over to the stack of crates. They form a rough tower almost as high as the inner wall, but the wood is rotting and soft to the touch. You look over the crates but can get no sense of what they contain. You open one of the lower crates, cracking the lid just a fraction. It appears they are filled with sludge, not gold.
I bet I can't cast some kind of spell to make them more substantial. I don't think I should try to climb them, so let's walk away.
Climbing would be suicide. The stack would topple, and if not, you would be seen. The tower in inner Manpeng awaits.
Yeah.
The old door. Is this what goes to the tunnel? You step over to the door, which is set in a low arch in a heavy stone wall that shields off inner Manpeng. It looks like it has not been opened in centuries. The hinges have rusted into red metal fists. The door is ancient. The handle is a large iron ring set on a rusted rivet. Surely it will not simply open if you turn.
Why not try, and then we'll use a knock spell or whatever they call it here.
Turn the handle. You reach for the handle when at that moment a guard emerges from a small doorway and calls to you. You there! Keep away from that.
Why?
No one touches that, the guard replies, on pain of the Archmage.
All right, let's not cause trouble. Step back. You lift your hand away. Good. The guard declares with a nod. I have knock spell in my head. Can do without scraping up another body from the ground. With that, he goes back inside the barrack block. Cast a spell. Wait, no, move away from the door. I clicked the wrong thing. You step away from the door once more and found another new clue. I can't rewind. Within the shadow of Manpang, all decisions are permanent. You may only rewind to places outside the Citadel. Well, I guess at this early point in the juncture, we can just play those parts over again, but I'd rather not. So what's our clue? Maybe it's best we not try it. It might just come out again. The inner city is sealed. There is no way from the outer yards of Manpang to the inner city. It is sealed to all. Maybe I can head back again. I don't know. I can. You leave the shadow of the door and step into the yard once more. A few clouds move across the sky. A few guards march from the outer gate to the door out of the yard. Where will you look next? What about this door? This small door. Oh, cool. You enter the shade of the barracks. The barracks are reasonably quiet. Most of the guards must be out on patrol. A closed door leads south. You pause to listen at the closed door to the south, and you hear the quiet sound of singing. The language you recognize, it is the common tongue of Annaland. Alright, let's check that out. You stride into the room. A horned humanoid creature stretches on a bed, looking as though he has only just woken up. He glances in your direction, opening a pair of exceptionally large eyes. They cover half his face, but the pupils are like those of a cat. Let me just look here. This is pretty cool in here. I like this. Anyway, look at his face. You look over his face with growing dread. This is a Sightmaster. What is a Sightmaster doing here inside the walls of Manpang? He blinks very slowly. Okay, as long as flames don't come out of his eyes, greet him. Greetings, sister, the Sightmaster remarks, nodding to you. You nod in return. He kneels before you. I have done terrible things, sister. Absolve him? You place a hand on his head and declare him freed from his sins. He nods gratefully. Thank you, sister, he murmurs. After what I did to my comrade and sergeant, I thought there was no hope for me. You freeze at the words. This is the one who betrayed the sergeant, whom you encountered at his end out of Lake Ilklala. You know? I could, but let's leave him. There's nothing you could do to save the sergeant, and any revenge might risk revealing you. Exactly. Without another word, you turn and leave, the traitorous Sightmaster still staring at the ground. Alright, back into the hallway. You step out of the Sightmaster's room and close the door behind. Along the hall. You hurry along the corridor. A powerful smell emerges from the smaller door on one side of the corridor. On the other side is what looks like a dormitory. Powerful smell. Inhale. You take a deep breath and then cough violently as you place the smell. The small door is a latrine, and the smell coming from it is truly foul. Okay. You could go either way down the corridor, but lingering would be a bad move. I don't know why. Watch me lose stamina here. And then I do want to check out the north door. You stride into latrines. What's it say? A bird in the hand can make a horrible mess. Vini, vidi, vomiti. Goblin, your food is bad for your elf? Dracula is a pain in the neck. What does this say? I can barely see that. Please wash your hands after using this towel. It says that there. The smell is horrendous. The room is filthy. Hundreds of flies buzz around a hole in the ground. From the look and smell of the place, it has never been cleaned. A grill in the back wall provides the only ventilation. Look through the grill. Standing on tiptoes, you peer out of the grill in the wall onto the mountain paths outside. The rocky slopes seem wonderfully safe to you now. Alright. Not sure what kind of... why we would cast a spell. You hold your breath and peer into the hole. It is too dark to see much, however, thankfully. Not reaching inside, no. The stench is too much. You stumble back, leaving the dark hole unexplored. You leave, gratefully. Yeah, I can't see how there'd be anything useful there. I mean, you never know. But, no. I'd end up fighting like an excretion monster or something. You step back into the hall and then gasp in fresh air. You could go either way from here. Alright, north door. You enter the room on the north side of the corridor. Cots line the walls. At the foot of each cot is a small chest. There is also a table in one corner piled with papers and scraps of food. A smaller door leads off to one side. Search the chests. You flip open a few of the chests and rifle through them. Manpeng's guards are a downtrodden lot to go by their meager possessions. The first few chests you open are entirely empty. Most likely the prospect of hot foods would be enough for many guards to sign up, and a threat of violence would convince the rest. More chests? You open a few more chests. In one you find a small pouch of gold. I think it added it already. But in another you find what is a more valuable prize, a complete guard's uniform. The size looks about right, though if you wear it you will have to take off the monk's habit and leave it behind. Let's put it on. You remove and discard the monk's habit, which is too large to carry with you, and then gather up the guard's uniform and put it on. Cool. You are now disguised as a guard. The fit is loose, but your face is well enough worn to give you the right look. The uniform should make for an effective disguise. You will now pass for a guard in Manpeng, though the truly sharp-eyed might tell the difference. You cast a quick look over your shoulder. A guard might appear at any moment. You glance over the cots. One has a strange-looking bundle of sheets on top. Then suddenly you are sent sprawling by a blow from behind. Roll sideways. You roll sideways, on instinct, expecting another blow to crash down where you fell, but it seems your attacker is still only half awake. I don't know who you are, but no one steals from the outer yard guard room. You've made a mistake. You begin, not me, the guard replies, booting you in the stomach. Get up, worm. No, I think spells don't work, though. Oh. Spells work now? Let's see what we got. Sleepiness. I do not have a brass pendulum. Invisibility. I do not have a pearl ring. That was the only N? Yeah. Okay, quicksand. I don't have sand. Cause fear. I don't have black face mask. I used to have one. I think that was stolen from me. G. Okay, G. Illusion of worship? What's that do? Alright. Illusion of worship. A lesser charm, according to my notes. Lesser charm. That seems to be the only thing I can cast. I checked M, I think. Yeah. Let me look at my spellbook. When this spell is cast, any creatures or humans nearby will take an immediate liking to the caster and will offer aid and information. This illusion spell can only be performed if the caster is wearing Jewel of Gold. Alright, let's do that one. It's the only option. I am God. You weave the constellations into a pattern around you, and your Jewel of Gold begins to shine and gleam. The man leaps to his feet and snaps to attention. My apologies, Watch Commander, he declares. I was merely preparing myself for duty. That's not good enough. The man gulps and nods fiercely. Yes, Commander. Sorry, Commander. He begins to rush for the door. Wait, you demand. The man freezes, and we can take advantage of this. How do I get inside Manpeng? The guard stares at you. No one crosses the wall, he replies, but I once heard there was a tunnel. Where is this tunnel? He smacks a salute against his forehead. If I knew, ma'am, I would shore it up, ma'am. Then something begins to slip. The spell is wearing off. The guard stares at you and rubs his eyes furiously. Dismiss him. You point sharply at the door. The guard nods and hurries away. Well, that was quick. Check the table. You shuffle the papers on top, finding little of interest. Letters to villages nestled in High Zaman, and a scorekeeping sheet for a dice game that must have been quite heated, since it is splattered with blood. Beneath that is a missive directing guards to kill on sight a weary-looking woman wielding a long sword. Okay. Look through the small door. Through the small door appears to be a changing and storage area. A few cloaks and bits of armor hang on hooks from the walls. Time to move on. Your clues have been updated. Hopefully you don't run into that guy again. What was updated? That's an old one. Yeah, I don't know what was updated. It looks the same to me. Let's check the side door, yeah. I didn't realize we could also go in there. You step through the doorway into a small dressing area. Benches line the walls under racks of hooks. Look under the benches. You kneel down to look under the benches, hoping to maybe find a key to the gate in the side yard, but you only find a few buttons and bits of ancient fluff. You paw through the cloaks, finding bits of uniforms. A hat here, a cloak there, a piece of shoulder armor, but nothing better than your current disguise. Pinned to the wall, though, is the shift rotation, scrawled in a rough hand. Let's read it. The list of names is large, nearly the size of a town's entire guard, assigned to the main gate and the side yards. Several groups are down to patrol the passes and the crater, while others patrol the outer walls. Just as you have suspected, none of these guards seem due to go inside the inner wall. You return to the main dormitory. You slip back into the main dormitory room. Best keep moving. Yeah, you could go either way from here. By the door. You stride confidently down the corridor, relying on your disguise to keep you out of trouble. Well, it didn't work last time. Murmuring voices reach your ears from somewhere close by. Listen. You still your breathing and listen, catching a few scraps of conversation from the door to the south. Has Varric heard about the Night Watch?
The Samaritans of Shin, comes an angry retort. That's what he thinks. Damn Samaritans are scoundrels. But this is not their style.
Hmm.
That has to do with the Shin. I just read the clue. The Birdmen of Shin. They call themselves something of Shin. They're told to ask after their mothers. They're unhappy with the Archmage. Listen more closely. You lean down to listen at the keyhole. There's no need for them to worry about the gates. Exactly. They can fly, right? Still, it's worrying, all right. There are hundreds of those blasted birdmen crawling around this place. The other voice continues. I'd kill the whole lot if it were up to me. I agree. Then there's a scrape of a chair and footsteps toward the door. Let's hide. You stand to the side of the door, melting into the shadows. The guard opens the door and walks right past you. Stay still. The guard moves a few steps away, then passes. You hold your breath, waiting. The guard turns and leans into the room once more. If you do see any this side of the wall, tie them up, she calls. Maybe we can do some investigations of our own. With that, she turns and strides away. The second guard leaves a moment later. The main yard beckons. Okay. So it looks like they've left that room. So let's check out this room. I'm waiting to see in a good choice, guys. There have been a few minor ones, but... Or that they left. Inside, you find a guard, mid-sentence, with fists raised. Behind her, another sits at a table, toying with a knife. Her eyes narrow. Her eyes flick across her disguise. What are you doing here? This isn't your barracks. This is an inspection. She straightens. Well, then look around. Not much to see, I admit. Thank you. You glance into the room, eliciting a nod from the second guard. The room is bare beside the table. Anything else we can do for you? The other guard asks. Who else is in these barracks? The guard wrinkles her nose. Some sightmaster. Comes from a distant land, and I hear they can see beyond the horizon. The Archmage brought a group of them from here to help watch the walls. Has his own room on account of how rare he is. Stuck up, if you ask me. A sightmaster from Annaland? She shrugs. Maybe, but talking to him, you'd think he's from the overworld above. Where's your captain? She's probably in the yard, kicking everyone into shape. She's easy enough to spot. The second guard beckons you near. She's in a right temper, though, so it might be best to give her a wide berth. Something about smugglers, I gather. This is the strangest inspection I've ever seen, the other guard remarks. You've not asked to see our daggers once. I'm not interested in your daggers. You reply smartly. If you can't keep them sharp, you'll be killed. Simple as that. She nods. Fair enough. I'm always in favor of easy inspections. It's good to be confident, right? Turn and leave. You turn for the door. Alright, let's go. You step back into the hallway. The main yard beckons. Which would be this. You step from the barracks into the main yard. The sun has reached its highest point now. The square is busy with traders and their porters carting goods from the gate to the high inner wall, where a rack of pulleys and ropes is in constant operation. As expected, there is no door in the wall into the city. Look around. Doors are set into the walls on either side of the yard. To the east, rich smells come from a noisy kitchen. To the west are barracks. Watch the pulleys. You watch the crews on top of the high wall, working the pulleys on top of the wall, transferring goods into the city inside. Perhaps there is a way to use them, but you cannot see one. There are scores of people working on every rope, and nowhere to hide. Watch the traders. Okay, had a little bit of trouble there. Okay. Most of the merchants are stopped at the gate, but a few are allowed to drive their carts all the way up to the far wall. Here, their goods are unloaded, strapped to ropes and hoist it over the wall, presumably into the Citadel proper. Gold coins are shuttled back again. It seems remarkably elaborate.
Talk to a merchant?
You find a merchant, waiting for a free rope. He nods a cautious greeting to you as you come to stand beside him. My papers are in order, just so you know.
Show them to me.
You demand. He waves a sheaf of documents at you. Right of yard entry. Stamped in, not yet stamped out. It's all legal.
What are you trading?
You ask. Leather, skins, and fibers. The merchant replies. It's a small enough trade, but it serves me well.
Where do you bring them from?
The Eastland, the merchant replies. Where else? It's not like I travel across the backlands. And he laughs heartily.
Have you ever been inside, Manpang?
You ask, watching the curious arrangement of pulleys and ropes. Of course I haven't, the merchant replies, looking at you curiously. I'm still here, aren't I? Are you new or something?
Of course not.
The merchant continues his puzzled stare, but says nothing else. He edges a fraction away from you. A hook descends near the merchant, and he nods farewell before setting about loading his crates onto the hook. No one pays you any attention. Clearly your disguise is good enough to serve.
I guess I'll head... This is the way back to the main gate. But we'll see what's here. I guess.
You wander back down the path towards the main gate. You are into the middle part of the day, and yet the Citadel is still cold. It is immediately clear this was once a grand entranceway. The remains of tall statues like those on the southern shore of Lake Ilklala line the road on either side, but their welcoming expressions have worn smooth, and their bodies have sheared. Each stands, or stood, twice your height, and their arms are all outstretched at different angles and orientations. They are clearly in the act of crafting magic. But which spell each is casting is all but impossible to tell. Many have lost their arms and many more their fingers, and most of the pursed, whispering mouths have crumbled to powder.
Count them. Well, I see 8. Let's approach one then, I guess.
The statue nearest to the gate is reasonably intact. Going over to it, you can make out a portion of a ruined inscription at its base. D0.
You can have a zero-sided dice.
What? Zero-sided die? The statue opposite also has a carving at its base.
Read the carving opposite.
You cross to the other side of the path and squat down, making out the letters OT.
Touch?
You reach out to touch the statue, only to burn your fingers. The statue is blazing hot.
Read the other carvings.
The next statue along the gate is broken at the waist and carved with F.A. at its base. It stands opposite another whose carving reads O.K.
Okay. F.A. Maybe foul spell? Touch the first statue.
You reach out and touch the first statue and feel a sudden lightness in your body. Are you floating a fraction off the ground?
Yeah. The other one's burning hot. Okay, so one's a levitate spell. This one...
You cross the path and touch the second statue. A sudden coldness leaks into your fingers, and you pull your fingers back sharply. A little gray dust trickles from your fingertips.
Gray dust.
Look for more carvings. You search the other statues for any more readable carvings, but one is missing entirely. Another two have been firmly destroyed, leaving only the last statue in the line which stands tall, arms raised upwards. It holds a stone vial upended in one fist and has a skull beneath its foot. Opposite the statue is nothing but an empty plinth. Carved at its foot are three characters overgrown with moss.
Clear the moss away.
You pull the clumps of moss free to reveal the name of the spell.
Zed.
You cannot hold back a shiver. This truly is the Fortress of Sorcerers, a place where the weirdest spell of all is not hidden away, but displayed in the main yard. Perhaps someone here even knows what the spell does. You hurry away from the statues, feeling as though they are watching you. I found three new clues. Now the Zed spell, I think, is the last spell. Yep. This is the most formidable spell in lore, but no one knows why. In all recorded history, this spell is only cast once by a powerful necromancer from Throbin who is never seen again. Its effects are unknown. The necromancer's notes were found, but were crazed and unclear. Treat with extreme caution. Yeah, the clues. The first crumble statues. Carved with D0 and OT. Or D-O and O-T. The other second statue is the F-A and O-K. And the fourth, a Zed spell. At the end of the path was opposite a statue of a sorcerer with an empty potion vial. And standing on a skull. Okay. Could be far, but I think it's foul. What were the other spells? Okay, and what else? Wait, clues. D-O, O-T. Okay. Rock. Oh, yeah. And dust came off on my hand. That's the rock spell. Foul. Basically, feather fall. That's the other one. The other one, D-O. Doc, maybe? What could be doze? Or dop. Knock spell. Cool. Alright. You stride back into the bustling yard, expecting the birdmen to swoop on you any moment. The sun is beginning to lower and the air begins to cool. Goods are being shuttled over the far wall almost constantly. A few guards nod to you as they march past. Alright, the kitchen's, I guess, the only place left to go from here. Opening the door a crack, you see a riot of activity and heat. Goblins rush between fires and low tables, carrying heaps of food and pots of water. An enormous hobgoblin stands at the front of the room, shouting orders and waving a cleaver above his head. You'll need to get into the larder to find the secret passage. Okay. Well, I'm gonna leave it here for a choice. Turn back is not a choice. I'm not leaving that open to choice. What do you think I should do? Creep in to find a secret passage in the larder? Or stride in, as if we own the place because I have our special guard uniform. So let me know what you guys think. Leave your votes in the comments below. We're going to creep in or sneak in to the kitchen. Thanks for watching, guys. Thanks for voting. And endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.